This is Lanny Poffo, formerly the genius full of glory and renown. You are listening to Damage 365 Radio.
Back with another edition of the All Night Long Wrestling Podcast. I am Commander Jingles, which I feel like is my new name because I was dancing like a monkey during that intro. But no, I am the Enforcer. He's the Stallion, and we're back with another episode. Welcome back, buddy.
What's a Commander Jingles?
I don't know. It's a name I came up with as I was watching myself dance in the tiny little.
Oh, okay, is it like one of the like the monkey with the drums with the cymbals and stuff like that? Is that what you're?
Yeah, it's my new thing.
Okay.
I could be the dancing stupid monkey. I don't know if I like that term.
No, I mean, we can workshop that. It's up for debate, I would say. Let's put it that way.
Listen, lots of stuff going on in the world of professional wrestling. We're not going to cover it, though. That's like what we're going to do. We're going to cover Progress Wrestling's coast-to-coast tour, making a stop in our home, not our hometown, our home state of New York 2 nights ago. August 7th, Progress coast to coast. Joe, it was your first full-length Progress show, true or false?
You emphasized full-length. Interesting. It's true. The first time I've sat and watched an entire Progress wrestling event, either on TV or in person.
Okay. We were at La Boom in Queens, right off the Woodside train station. Nice and easy, thankfully. It's a good venue. We've been there 7-8 times now. Is that fair?
Yeah, somewhere around there. Evolve and Shine Wrestling also have events there.
We're familiar with the layout, familiar with the atmosphere, the arena, the people there. To me, this event was like any other I've seen at that venue.
It was a different crowd for sure. And you couple that with the fact that the show was taking place on a Tuesday night in Queens. So, it was, I think they said it was sold out. I don't know how much sold out is, but with the way the arena is laid out, there's obviously a bunch of seats that are around the ring. And then there's some seats on the side at kind of tables by bars. And then there's some standing room spots as well. And there were, a decent amount of people that were standing, I guess, with general admission tickets. So there was a very good turnout, I would say, for a Tuesday night show.
A Tuesday night show in a monsoon.
Yeah, the lightning bolts were coming down from above that night, for sure. And, we knew it was going to be a near-death experience going in. So there wasn't any surprises really there as far as that was concerned. But, did we stand out in the rain and the lightning and the thunder to get inside
sure
the
building? Yep.
Absolutely, we did. But that's what you do when you're a dedicated wrestling fan
on a Tuesday,
appreciators of the craft like we are.
Not marks. We're not marks. We're appreciators. Actually, it could be marks. We're going to be smart marks, right? Like, those are the douches. It's safe to say, like, how about wrestling nerds? Are we wrestling nerds?
I was going to say elitists, right? Wrestling elitists.
Actually, if anybody's elitist, I think it's BK and Kyle who shit on me for watching anything outside of WWE. So I think maybe they're a little more wrestling elitist.
That's a hot take. That's a hot take.
That is.
Well, let's just say that we appreciated the differences between different promotions and shows that we get put on. But Progress, for those who may or may not know, is a company based out of the UK. And they're on a United States tour currently, and one of their stops happened to be out here. So, short story long, we ended up getting tickets to the show and sat there front row thankfully, for Tuesday night's event. Yes.
What we do. Hashtag front row guys.
We have to meet a few people before the show, right, as well. We can talk about that when you're ready. But.
Yeah, absolutely. I just want to say the thing I noticed first and foremost is when we walked up, dude, the line was wrapped around the building. And no show I've ever been to has ever been that long. I mean, Shine made us stay outside. Was that Evolve or Shine? No, it was Shine. Mm-hmm. And we had to stay outside in like 11 degrees for like an hour. But no, this one was wrapped around the building, you know, and you looking at the crowd, they look, I'm not here to stereotype or make poor judgments or say words that shouldn't be said, but this crowd, just looking at it, have the look of an ECW crowd to me. You know, they had, because, I mean, Progress markets himself as punk rock pro wrestling, and I think that's kind of, that's their clientele, and that's who was there. And I think that kind of crowd, without being disrespectful, made for a very hot crowd and a good show. You hear the dogs, right?
I can see them, yes.
Oh, nice. That's Hunter's humping him. That's a shoot. Oh, now he's going for double leg. Fantastic. Oh,
there it goes. All right.
And we're gone. But the crowd was hot from the beginning. So listen, let's get – there were seven matches. Yeah, seven matches announced for every show. Unfortunately – couple injuries, things got shuffled around. Kid Lykos, one half of CCK, the Calamari Catch Kings, broke his collarbone. You guys are being dicks. Broke his collarbone. So he was replaced by Jonathan Gresham, which is awesome because you and I are big fans of the old Octopus.
The Octopus, sure, yeah.
And, you know, last minute they also, after the event was sold out, they added Matt Riddle, who wrestled in Progress a bunch of times. So I think they did a better job this year than last year of bringing over the talent from the UK. Last year it was more of an Evolve show under the Progress banner. This year it seemed more like a Progress show with some other guys sprinkled in, so... That being said, man, let's get into it. Show starts off. Jim Smallman comes out, welcomes us to the show. The crowd was live from the beginning. And the opening match tonight was Eddie Dennis versus T.K. Cooper. You not seeing either of these guys before, what was your first impression?
They looked like opening match guys, I would say. Just based off of how, you know, their appearance and entrance and things like that. But the crowd, like you said, was hot. So, you know, the opening match usually gets a pretty good reaction almost no matter what. So Dennis was playing the heel here. Cooper, the babyface, he apparently last year at the show in New York, which I believe was in the Bronx, had broken his leg doing a dive off the top rope. So that was kind of played up a little bit during the match with him doing a couple of dives here and there. But the match itself was solid for what it was. I mean, I have not seen either guys work very much, but there were really no bad spots or anything like that. The match itself I thought was entertaining and, you know, for the opener. And Dennis got the win with a little bit of cheating, but he kind of used the referee to his advantage at one point near the finish. And he ended up getting the Duke, as they say.
Yeah, for this match, I wrote down...
What do you got?
I got Eddie Dennis, douche with great hair. That's what I put down for the match. You know, TK Cooper last year, like you said, he snapped his leg. Guys,
they're good now. It looks like they're okay.
He literally snapped his leg in half last year, so I like how they played up to it. Opening match, I went solid 2 stars across the board.
Yeah, I went like 2.5. I mean, it, you know, again, it solidly worked. I don't know either guy, but sometimes that's not a bad thing. You know, you're going into a show and seeing guys with a fresh set of eyes, so you don't have any preconceived notions about what they can do or what you expect, right? So, you know, again, I didn't have any issue with either guy. Not that. You know, I should have, but they worked a solid match, so I probably went 2.5 stars for that.
Life is about tapering expectations, Joe, and that's what I'm good at. Next match of the night was Natalia Markova versus Ashley Vox, and Markova we saw a bunch of times on Shine. The winner of this match got put into the four-way at the last Progress show, I believe in Detroit. So match was a little slow and clunky, I would say, in the very beginning. But once the crowd really got behind Ashley Vox, they picked up. And then some of Markova – Markova's not the smallest woman in the world. She's athletic, she's in shape, but she's a little bit of a bigger girl. And the stuff that she was able to do in the match, I mean, had the crowd going crazy. She took a couple of very, very bad falls to the outside. That I remember, like, got a bunch of holy shit chants, and everybody was like, it was one of those. But I actually thought Vox was going to win this, but Markova wound up getting the win with a, I don't know what you would call it. I called it a running sit-out X-Factor. I believe that's the safest assumption for what the move was.
Yeah, I guess, you know, with the X-Factor, the whatever you want to call it, face buster or something like that, you know, usually they would grab the opponent's head and then you sit out and drag them face first into the mat. So she just got a running start on Vox when she did it. But yeah, I mean, it was, you know, sort of that like a standard contest. And then they did a couple of spots where, you know, Markova did a dive to the outside and Vox moved. So Markova just hit the floor and there was not a lot of mat space.
There were three puzzle mats on the outside about yay big. It was like maybe eight tops.
She hit the floor pretty hard on that, and then Vox did a dive right after that. And again, when she connected with that, they both hit the ground pretty hard. Specifically, Markova. So she had taken back to back pretty tough bumps. But after that, there was some good action. There was some good near falls, and the crowd was really, really into it towards the end. So I give them a lot of credit. Again, it was not a lot of sloppiness or anything to it. So seemed like it was well worked. I don't know much about how long either of these women have been in the business. I probably should have researched that before speaking on it, but I liked the match a lot and I gave it 3.25 stars.
3.25. I went 3 stars for this match. I thought, again, like everything you said, it picked up towards the end. They overcame like a slow start, I feel like. And man, they picked it up and the crowd was super behind them.
That's because you hate Putin, so.
What's that?
You hate Vladimir Putin. I just assume that's why you went 3 instead of 3.25.
No, I don't hate Vladimir Putin. I just love America. That's all. Next, one of the matches I was most looking forward to, which got announced the day of, which is crazy. Mark Haskins versus Flash Morgan Webster in a submission match. Flash Morgan Webster is a fantastic, limey douche heel. His mannerisms are great. He kind of has that Austin Powers look. He looks super young when you see him in person, didn't he? He looked like he was 15.
Yeah, he did look very young. I'd only seen him. So these are two guys that have appeared in, I don't know, whatever you would call it, the WWE NXT UK brand or shows or tournaments. So some people that do not follow Progress might be familiar with these guys if you watch some of the NXT UK specials. And that's where I had seen Flesh Morgan Webster for the first time. Haskins, I think I had seen before a couple different spots. So, but yeah,
there's a submission. Jay Briscoe, not too long ago too. Yeah,
yep. There you go. So it was a submission match, and I think there was some heat involved with the storyline, right? Because Webster had done something to Haskins' wife Vicky recently. You were telling me.
Yeah, they were actually a tag team for a long time. It was Flesh Morgan Webster, Haskins, and Vicky Haskins, and somebody else whose name, and Jimmy Havoc. Hello. And what happened was they were kind of, Flash was kind of the whipping boy until it was a double turn. So he kind of turned heel, which in turn kind of turned Haskins' face. And in the last match, at Midweek Matters, chapter 74, he came out and he kind of put his hands on Vicky Haskins, which got great heel heat. So which kind of set up the little blood feud right now.
I got you. Yep. Yeah. So no, that kind of gave the submission stipulation a little bit of, you know, justification there. So they worked, you know, again, that was the only rule, was that it was submission only. So then there were some things that were like chairs and some weaponry was used during the course of the match. And I did appreciate the fact that they were consistently going for submissions throughout the bulk of the match. You know, oftentimes you'll see a submission match and guys will just work kind of a regular match for the first 5 to 10 minutes and then start going for the submissions later. You almost kind of remembering that, hey, by the way, I got to win by submission. So these guys were going for submissions almost right from the get-go, which I appreciated. And they were wearing each other down with some other moves and weapons during the course of the match, which I thought was, you know, it's good. I appreciate seeing little things like that. So
psychology, huh?
Just stuff that makes sense. That's really all I'm looking for. So,
including some of the most vicious chops we've ever seen up close, like literally about 4 inches from us.
Yes.
When yeah, there was some chopping Flash. It was like, oh, that was a tough one. But I really, really enjoyed this match, and I went 3.75 star.
Yeah, I went 3.5. So I'm right around the same range as you. I mean, the finish.
English? Do you not drink tea?
I don't drink tea, actually, but that doesn't really have much, not much of an influence on my take on the match, maybe some, but the finish kind of came about when Vicky Haskins